Morning, everybody, on this beautiful day again. Just love being here, love worshipping God. Did you realise that the Roman centurion, who was a Gentile overseeing Jesus' execution, becomes the first person in Mark's gospel account to identify the crucified Jesus as the Son of God, a Gentile? Mark 15, 38 and 39 says, "Surely this man was the Son of God." And then women are the first witnesses of his resurrection. Oh, thank you. Gentiles and women were not permitted to approach the presence of God in the tabernacle, especially the Holy of Holies. But when the huge, heavy temple curtain tore, tearing from the top of the curtain down to the bottom, this was a deliberate act of God that the death of Jesus granted access for all people, men, women, Gentiles alike, to come into God's presence. I'm sure each of us have thought, I wonder what the priests and Pharisees thought when that temple curtain was torn. Interestingly, Mark's gospel account ends abruptly with the women running away from the tomb, confused, bewildered, in fear, in awe. They were viewed as second-rate citizens by society, but they had been travelling with Jesus from the beginning. It was women also who had been providing funds for living expenses for Jesus and the disciples as they proclaimed the good news of the kingdom of God. In Luke 8:3, we read, these women were helping to support them out of their own funds. Why would Mark specifically mention about a Gentile and marginalised women? When we read different accounts of what the women may or may not have exactly done at the tomb, it is evident that the women initially were not believed and probably were brushed aside by others. Maybe Mark leaves his gospel open-ended, purposefully, so to speak, so that each of us might gauge our own response to the works of Jesus' life and the empty tomb. So, who is Jesus to you? It doesn't matter who we are. Jew, Gentile, man, woman, child, young, old, king, servant. We are all accepted by God into his family as one body of believers. Jesus died for everyone. So who is Jesus to you? Who is Jesus to me? Each of us needs to honestly answer this important question before we start to fellowship in communion. Who is Jesus to me? Who is Jesus to you? Jesus invites those who have accepted him as their personal Lord and Saviour to remember him through the eating of the wafer and drinking the juice in memory of his forgiveness and defeat of sin through his death on the cross, through his resurrection, and with his promise to return one day to take us to be with him forever. This is what we celebrate in awe and reverence this morning, no matter who we are or where we've come from. So just this morning, just take a few moments before you step forward to partake in communion here. Serve yourselves then, hold on to the juice, and we'll drink it together as a united family because Jesus died for everyone, no matter who we are and where we've come from. So please, just a couple of moments, prepare your heart, come and serve yourself, hold on to the juice, and then we'll drink together. Thank you. I'd just like to pray and then we'll all drink together. So just pray with me, would you please? Gracious and loving Father, thank you for giving Jesus to die for everyone and providing the way for us to be accepted as your children into your family. Thank you that your will is to bring unity to all things in heaven and earth, being of one heart and mind, no matter what our origins are. We know that work done in unity among the people of God releases the power of God. Thank you for showing us perfect unity in the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We love you and we humbly thank you for all you are and all you have done and all you will continue to do. And may it be all for your glory that we pray. Amen. Please, let's drink. I'd just like to lead us all now into just a time of corporate prayer, where we just bring things before the Lord. I know, as we always say, there's always prayer points in our bulletin that we can keep focusing on during the week. And I know I do this sort of semi-regularly when I have the opportunity and the privilege to pray. I like to just have a moment of sort of quiet where we can all just bring particular thoughts and prayers and thankfulness and praise to God before I do a corporate prayer on our behalf. So I know in our prayer focus here, we've always got the people who God blesses us with to bring the message each Sunday. And obviously this morning, we're really thankful, Colin, again, that you're willing and able to come and present God's word to us. So we really thank you and your family. And, you know, the other folk, Unia, Naomi, Neil, Steve, just so many people that God has blessed us with for so many months. And that's such a praise point, and we should be really lifting them up in prayer as we, you know, just thank God for these people. Kids Hope, always, how wonderful is that opportunity? That's just something that I hope we're all keeping in our hearts as well as we support those kids and the people who've said that. I have permission to say this, so I'll say it, but I'm not sure if everybody knows that Kerry Deva has sold his home, his and Marion's home, and he's moving to Maclay Island, and that'll be in the next little while if it's not already happened this weekend, but it's coming up. So Marion at the moment is still at Booper in Mackenzie Street, and if anyone is available, she'd love to have some visitors. And so she's on the waiting list to be relocated to a place closer to where Kerry and the rest of his family and that will be, over near Maclay Island. So that's something just to keep them in our prayers too, that it all goes well. And God's obviously in control and Kerry knows that, and the timing is just pretty good. So we'll just keep them in our prayers too. But I know it's not an our prayer focus, but Kerry did say I could tell people that, so that's really good. Anyway, let's just a few moments of quiet and then I'll just pray to finish off. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this morning. Thank you for the fact that we are just able to approach you. There's no curtain, there's no barrier because of what Jesus has done. And we are truly thankful. We give you all the glory and all the praise, Lord, that is due to you for your wonderful love and your sacrifice for us so that we can be in this beautiful relationship with you. And Lord, as people have brought as we've all brought things before you this morning, we just lay our hearts open to you and just trust you for your guidance, trust you for the answers to our prayers in your timing, because you are faithful and we just thank you, Lord. You are good. No matter what goes on around us, you are good. You are worthy of our praise because you are God. You provide for us, you strengthen us, you deliver us, and you heal us. Even if we don't see you at work in our lives for whatever reasons, that doesn't change the fact, Lord, that you are working and preparing us for good works you planned in advance for us to do. So, Lord, regardless of what we face today, tomorrow, this week coming, in the future, may we hold fast to your faithfulness that you are with us, that we can bring these prayer requests to you and that you hear us. And Lord, you will answer in your time, in your perfect way. And we thank you. And Lord, we just offer a special prayer for those who aren't able to be with us today, enjoying the holiday season, enjoying the beautiful creation around us. Lord, we just pray your blessing on them and that they will return safely to us once this period of a break is over. And Lord, we just offer you our thanks. Thank you for this day. Thank you that we're able to be together. And Lord, we just love you and we thank you. And we offer this up in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, announcements. Ladies.
Oh, Mark, so exciting.
So you would have got your little invitation. So we are looking forward to the big birthday coming up. So follow what the instructions are on the invitation for Mark's special birthday. I won't say it over, you know, anything. Oh, we all know, she's going to be 70. What the heck? So good. So that's right. Make sure you RSVP if you're able. Pastoral care, remember, a big reminder for everyone, we're all pastoral care people. So ring up someone, organise a catch-up, send an email, do whatever. Let people know that you're thinking of them and praying for them. I think that's really good. Don't forget the AGM, 29th of October. It should be in your diaries already because we've already said it so many times, but double check. So plan to be here because it's good. I like AGMs. You just get to talk and see what's and remind yourself of what's been going on. So it's a good morning and it's a good meeting after church. Holidays, no kids' life. So Holly, your kids, they know where to go and have whatever they need. So that's really good. The latest Withcott Times are out and a very good article from Bob and Tracy about Operation Christmas Child, which I will now introduce Bob and Tracy to tell us a little bit more about that. So I think I've finished everything. Thanks for being here today. What a great day. So after Bob and Tracy, we'll welcome you, Colin.
I'll start. There's a game, unrelated public service announcement. It's a Christmas card for our child that is being supported by the church in Zimbabwe through Global Mission Partners, and his name is Makawashi. There's a Christmas card. If anyone can sign it, and it's going to get to him so that it can get, it's got to be done now so that we can get it to Christmas in time. And talking about Christmas, Operation Christmas Child is part of a group called Samaritan's Purse. Samaritan's Purse operate in many countries and they deliver aid to earthquakes and floods and famine, and even here in Australia at Goodna. They were up working when the floods in Goodna. They're still working in Lismore. So they're not just out there, they're here in our own country too. But part of Operation Christmas Child, part of Samaritan's Purse is, of course, our shoebox ministry, which we've been doing for quite a long time in this church. Tracy and I first saw the shoebox ministry, which go to children in overseas countries, in 2000. And then we brought it to this church in 2001, and we've been doing it since. And since then, we reckon there's about 2,000 shoeboxes that have gone to children around the world from this church alone. So that's a bit exciting. So, what's that? You want to say something? No. So, shoeboxes, it's very exciting. I'm going to move along. And I just get... I'm not going to deconstruct it. But you can see there's shoeboxes here. And what's it all about? So really, it's an opportunity for you to give to a child other than your own in another country far away. They deliver these shoeboxes, and they're full of Christmas gifts, if you want to call it that. And they partner with the local church, and the local church then is able to present these shoeboxes to kids in need, which there's a lot of kids in need, and they can get a gift from someone that they don't even know. And that is just so exciting. I mean, it's always great to receive, but it's better to give. So if we move along to the idea of what how to pack a shoebox. Rotating the slides around. This is not what I wanted to see, but find a shoebox. So I've already made pre-prepared shoeboxes. They're fun to fold up, but they're easier if you can pinch one. There's a whole heap of them out there ready to fold up. I got it down to 60 seconds the other day when I was folding them. There's a trick to it, because if you can't do it, it's really... So I wasn't going to give you all one of these shoeboxes to fold. But I've made these ones, and these aren't just for display. These are for you to take home and fill up with good stuff for kids. So we found a shoebox. Next.
You can get them from the multi-purpose room, or you can use a shoebox. You don't have to have the pre-painted ones.
Good-o. So choose a boy or a girl. That's easy.
Yeah, he's going real quick.
Fill it with gifts. So what we've done over here, Tracy's set up this deconstructed shoebox. So there's all sorts of things you can fill it up with. So once you choose your child, or a girl or a boy, the idea is that you would fill it with certain items. So let's go to the next one. A wow item, okay? A wow item could be a stuffed toy, a ball, an outfit of clothing, small musical instrument, skipping rope, yo-yos, that sort of thing. The next one on there is personal care item, toothbrush, little blanket, washcloth, bar of soap, those sort of things. Clothing accessory, hair clips for kids, for girls, maybe boys, but hair clips. Hats, underwear, sunnies, that sort of thing. Crafts and activities. Okay, so writing paper, colouring in book, that sort of thing. Little things to put together. You might get them from Woolies even, that you can put these things together.
Toys.
Whoa, geez. So many toys that can fit into a shoebox. But yes, that sort of thing. So it becomes exciting. Next. And a personal note. Believe it or not, they encourage you to either put in a photograph or a personal note saying how much it's a pleasure to give someone a gift. So, and they'll read it and they'll treasure it. Moving right along. Don't include.
You can't even read it.
Food, lollies, chocolate, stuff like that, toy guns, things of warring, things, that sort of thing. So don't include it. Don't include toothpaste, anything liquid. No, 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 no. So there are some things that we can't give them. So just be aware of that. Pray. Yes, of course, you're going to be giving a gift to someone that you don't even know who they are. So you want to pray for that gift to meet their need. Also, their little hearts will be just so overjoyed and so excited. and it'll be a great opportunity. Next. Oh, yeah, label and donate. So once you choose your boy or a girl that has labels, which look, you won't see it on here, boop, boop, but it's a boy or a girl, you tick the box, 2 to 4, 5 to 8, 10 to 14, then you should, it's a good idea to donate, because as you know, anything in the post costs money these days, and it happens to be $12.50 per box, but it is a donation. So there's people that support Operation Christmas Child throughout the year to cover the cost of shoeboxes that people can't afford to donate for, but there is an opportunity to donate as well, the $12.50. And there is these brochures at the back, or you can get it online if you're savvy. That's pretty good. Next, drop off church. You want to talk about that? No? She's ready. Okay, so drop it off. We are an official drop off station for our area, and we'll have them here available to drop off. There is information about that. It's around about, I can't remember the date.
But I've got the date.
You've got the date. I'll let Tracy talk now.
Are you not saying all? No?
No,
there you go. Okay. So just some things, yeah, for you. So grab a box. You can grab a pre-made one. You can grab the flat ones out the back. You can have your own. Also out the back, there's baskets. I always shop for children. My children now know, they're like, oh, is that for the shoebox, kids? So I'm like, yes. So there is baskets out the back. If you want to take stuff from those baskets to make your box, you can. If you don't want to put a whole box together, you can buy goods to go in those baskets. This year I haven't bought many stationery items or books or things like that. I've sort of bought other things. So yeah, you can either add to the baskets or take, whatever you wish to do. The other thing, of course, is money. Always need money for things. So you can give, you can spend money and make your own. You can give money to help the boxes get shipped. You can give money for someone to buy goods if you're not able to get out yourself. You can give online, or you can give in envelopes through the church, or you can give to us. Of course, praying, anyone can pray, and just, yeah, praying that the boxes get there safely and for the people who receive them. Going to have again another pizza packing party on October the 20th. So if people want to come to the church in that Friday evening, help pack the boxes of all the baskets that we do have, you're quite welcome. On the same day as the general meeting, we will have probably, in a sense, the close-off date for putting your boxes here. And then throughout that week, I hope then just the last ones will trickle in. And then in that week, then I hope to drive to Minden to deliver all our boxes. This year, Minden Church has secured a big, huge container. You know more sizes. I just know
40 foot.
It's a container where we can take our shoe boxes instead of taking them to Brisbane this year. Last Friday night, we actually got the opportunity to go to Minden Church. They had a night there that we're invited to, and in that evening they had a presentation about the shoe boxes. But then we got to listen to a lovely lady who I can never remember her name.
Angie.
So, yeah, got to meet Angie, and she got up the front and spoke. And Angie is from Malawi, and she got to tell us the most amazing story. She grew up in Malawi, and of course, as it happens with many children overseas, her parents had passed away. So she was living and growing up with extended family. She said, her life wasn't too bad in a sense. She had people who did look after her and care for her, and she did go to school. But she still was in amongst a whole lot of people living together, and they didn't really have anything as such. She got to go to school, but that was it. So when she was about 8 or 9, she received a shoebox, and she's probably in her 30s now, still remembers that day, still remembers the joy that she had. Each member who was living in the family, all the children, everyone got one. So she finally, there was something that was her, something that belonged to her that she could have. And yeah, it just lives with her forever, that this wonderful gift of receiving the shoebox. She remembers every item that she got and she treasures it greatly. For her in her life, she then moved to Canberra, and fortunately for her, she couldn't take anything with her, but she still has memories of what she received. She then lived in Canberra with further extended family and grew up there, and then within her life she then moved to Sydney and then now has moved to Ipswich. And she saw somewhere the colours and, yeah, immediately remembered the gift that she got and received. And she's now a young mum with three kids, and as soon as she saw it, then she's got on board with it, and she rounds up her children and got boxes delivered so she then could go out within her community and tell everyone about the amazing gift that she received and the gift that you can enjoy. So that was just really great. So, yeah, happy shoeboxing.
Happy shoeboxing. So I might just pray and then we'll move on from there. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that we're able to give a gift to someone that we don't even know, and they don't even know why we've given it to them. Lord, I think it's an amazing opportunity for us to really somehow connect a little bit to what you did for us and the gift that you've given us, and that we can be able to have the opportunity to give a gift to a child in need somewhere that probably doesn't even deserve a gift, but they have the opportunity to receive a gift. Lord, I just really thank you for this opportunity. Lord, I pray for the boxes. I pray for the opportunity to work with the local churches within these communities. And we just really pray for this type of outreach. In your name, we pray this. Amen. Colin, welcome to the stage. Are you going to introduce Colin or do I do? Colin, welcome.
We on? Yes, we're on. It's good when technology works too, isn't it? Well, it's good to be here with you together again this morning and sharing God's word. I wonder, how's your week been? Has it been busy? I know for me personally, it's been crazy. I've done three funerals and a wedding. And then the last week, my wife and I shared communion in the hospital and prayed with a dear friend on the Tuesday, and then she passed on the Wednesday. And later on, we tripped down to Tamworth on Thursday to help someone move, all the while for preparing for some of our young people from Kingsthorpe that have gone over to Vanuatu, which Sandy shared this morning, brought back some really precious memories for her. So many things go on, even good things. But the craziness of it all made it so much harder, so much more difficult to spend that quality time with Jesus. That quality time with Jesus and hearing his voice. And while there's been personal chaos, I couldn't help but stop and think about the chaos and confusion and fear in our world today, where darkness continues to come in and try and masquerade itself as a form of light. It's a sad reality in the church world today that there are false Christs. There are false spirits and false gospels, such as the progressive gospel that attempts to add Christ to fit into your world. And your truth and is no longer like the Christ in the Bible. Folks, it's so, so important in this day and age that we get into the Bible and know and walk in the truth with the real Jesus following the real gospel. I think of a saying that we have as churches of Christ, where the word speaks, we speak. Where it's silent, we're silent. We desperately need to hear God's voice because of all that is going on around us. And in our humanness, we can be overcome with a kind of fear that can lead on to the erosion of our faith. Fear is real. And we can so often become paralyzed and miss embracing all that God has in store for us. But folks, faith in Jesus will enable us. Amen. If you've got your Bibles with you this morning, we're going to have a look at a very familiar passage from 1 Samuel. But before we tuck in, why don't we have a word of prayer together? Oh Lord, we thank you this morning for who you are. Thank you that we can come before you with thankful hearts. We're thankful for your word. We're thankful for our relationship with you and the timeless truth that's within your word. Thank you that you want to use us to change us. And I pray that this morning we will really want to hear your voice and walk with you. Come and have your way in my heart, Lord, and in all of our hearts. We want to be a people that are passionately in love with you and share all that you are with those around us. Holy Spirit, would you please bring your spirit of revelation to our hearts and to our minds. Help us to understand your word and what you want to say to us. And we ask all these things in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Well, some of you might be familiar. There's a parable in Matthew chapter 21 that says, a man had two sons. And he came to the first and he said, go work today in my vineyard. He answered and said, I will. Not, but afterward he regretted it and went. Then the father came to the second son and said, likewise. And he answered and said, I go, sir, but he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? It was the one who chose to do the job, even though he had said no at first. I wonder how many times you and I have heard God speak to us. And we know that he has and that he's very clearly asked us to do something. But just like in a relationship between parents and their children, we can say yes and then don't follow through. Or we can say no, but then we can change our mind and obey. You see, friends, God has given each one of us free will. He's given us the ability and the will to choose. In the parable that was just read, two men were both given the same opportunity. But they both made different choices and they had very different outcomes. One man just heard and the other really listened and then followed that up with an action. You see, friends, hearing is simply the act of perceiving sound by the ear. But listening is something that you and I consciously choose to do. The concept of listening and choosing is something that was introduced by God. We find that it's mentioned 149 times in the Old and the New Testaments. In 1 Samuel, a father is mentioned in Scripture. Some of you might remember, he was a man named Eli. He was the second last high priest of Israel. His job was to listen and perform all that God had commanded him. But over time, he had chosen to become a hearer and not a listener. Eli, the great high priest, the one that was supposed to be close to God and mediate between the people and God, had let his relationship between God and himself disintegrate. And the fruit of this relationship being in a mess was not listening and discerning correctly. Eli heard, but he didn't listen. And I've often wondered why. Let's tuck into 1 Samuel chapter 1 and have a look at verses 4 to 17 together. 1 Samuel chapter 1, verses 4 to 17. If you've got your Bibles, if you'd like to follow along, but we'll also have it up on the screen as well. And it says, whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat to his wife Peninnah and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave a double portion because he loved her. And the Lord had closed her womb. Because the Lord had closed Hannah's womb, her rival kept provoking her in order to irritate her. This went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not eat. Her husband Elkanah would say to her, "Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons?" Once then they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up now. Eli the priest was sitting on his chair by the doorpost of the Lord's house. Verse 10. In her deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, weeping bitterly, and she made a vow, saying, "Lord Almighty, if you will only look on your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your son, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head." And she kept on praying to the Lord, and Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was praying in her heart and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. Eli thought she was drunk and said to her, "How long are you going to stay drunk? Put away your wine." "Not so, my Lord," Hannah replied. "I am a woman who is deeply troubled. I have not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I have been praying here out of my great anguish and grief." Eli answered, "Go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you've asked of him." You see, friends, Eli heard Hannah crying in the temple, but he wasn't truly listening. Why? Was he afraid of the state that he would find her in? Was he afraid of how his reputation as a spiritual man would be tarnished? You see, to Eli, Hannah's cries, they were coming from a drunk woman. And he wanted to get rid of her quickly. Sadly, Eli, he was focused on the exterior and he didn't listen to Hannah's heart. He didn't listen and discern with spiritual ears, but with his own natural wisdom and ability. Have you ever done that before? I know I have. Maybe you've been in a situation or in a conversation where you've been very quick to hear something, and you form a judgment based on your own natural understanding without really listening and discerning correctly. Whenever we're hearing, friends, let's always ask the Lord to help us really listen to what is being said. If we're in a conversation with one another or a neighbor or passing by someone on the street, Let us be quick to listen and slow to speak. And not just with people, but especially when we're praying, when we're talking to the Lord. You see, the writer of the book of Ecclesiastes knew this well and encourages us that God is in heaven and we're here on earth. Therefore, we should let our words be few. It's pretty good advice, isn't it? We live such busy lives. And because we do, how much more should we take time to really listen to what the Lord is saying to us individually and collectively as His church, and not rely on our own human wisdom and ability? Thankfully, Eli did realize eventually that Hannah was actually pouring out her heart to the Lord and blessed her on the way home. In time, God heard Hannah's prayer and gave her a son, Samuel. Hannah kept her promise to the Lord and dedicated him to the Lord and to work with Eli in the temple. But as Samuel begins to grow and work with Eli, we not only find that there is a spiritual famine that's taking place within Eli's heart, but it was something that was also taking place throughout the nation as a whole. Verse 1 of chapter 3, it reads, "The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions." Even though Eli was the great high priest, it didn't mean for one moment that his children were going to walk in his footsteps. Eli had two sons, and again we see free will at work. Yes, Eli's sons did serve in the temple, but their heart was not dedicated to God. And the Bible goes on to tell us that Eli's sons were scoundrels. They had no regard for the Lord. You see, Eli's sons chose to worship themselves. They lived for themselves and for what gave them pleasure. And instead of their father influencing them, they influenced their father against the Lord. Friends, we were created as a people of faith to worship God, to be connected to Him with a growing faith. But if we are not surrendering everything to God with our whole lives, and we will fill that place with something or someone else. Each one of us needs to be people of God's word with a growing spiritual discernment, to know what's God and to know what isn't, to know that which seeks to drown out the voice of God and fill our hearts with fear instead of faith. You see, when my wife Rebecca and I go and sit with someone in their final moments, I'm going to be really honest with you this morning. Sometimes I wonder, what on earth are we going to be walking into? How will a person be? Will they be fearful of death? Or will they be full of faith and ready to see Jesus? I tell you, friends, this one dear sister on Tuesday the other week, she was sitting up in her bed and singing with as much strength as she could, "When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that'll be. When we all see Jesus, will sing and shout the victory." She wasn't afraid. She was ready to go. No matter what our station in life, friends, in life or in death, you and I have the testimony of Christ in our lives. And we may be the only Bible that someone ever reads. We might be the only example of faith in Jesus that our children read, that our families see and hear. I love the reminder back in Deuteronomy where we're encouraged to live as a family, and the things of God are to be something that is a natural way of life. Do we share the things of God with our children and with our grandchildren? Do you read and talk together about God? Not in a church setting, but in all things that you do together. Right throughout the week, as you share a meal together, maybe you're getting their hair ready for school. As you're traveling in the car, walking down the street, whatever it is, you name it. As we live our ordinary everyday lives, is God a real and vibrant part that we share with one another? As natural as breathing as we are here today. Just as children need a firm foundation and leading in their lives, you and I, we desperately need it in our lives as well. And Scripture encourages us to come as children to our Heavenly Father. We need to embrace God's kingdom like a child, forever learning and enjoying God's presence in simplicity. Each one of us need to find our own walk with the Lord and trust in His plan of salvation for ourselves. You see, because we can't make it into heaven on our parents' faith or on our friends' faith or on our spouse's faith, even though we might even have a heritage of faith and have family that ministers, this does not give us instant access to God. I love the reminder from Charles Spurgeon, who once said, "Train up a child in the way you should go, but be sure you go that way yourself." Good reminder, isn't it? Eli had Samuel under his care, but he wasn't walking the way that he should have been. Most of you will probably know this part of the story really well. One night, Samuel is about to turn in for some rest, but he was in for a bit of a surprise. He was about to enter into the training camp of learning to listen and know the voice of God for himself, all while Eli was asleep. Two times God called out to Samuel, and each time he thought it was Eli that was calling for him. So he gets up and he goes and he wakes Eli up. Eli tells him no, he didn't call him, and go back to sleep. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not been revealed, not yet been revealed to him. A third time the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down. And if he calls you, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. I don't know about you, but I can just picture Eli, and he's all groggy with sleep after having to get up. Maybe he's even a little grumpy. You know that just as you're drifting off, and wham, you're woken up again. As it happened before with Hannah, Eli took a while to listen and discern correctly about what was going on. He had to stop and really listen. And only then could he give the instructions that Samuel needed to hear. Samuel, who had a soft and willing heart, followed and obeyed Eli's instruction. He went on to find direction as God revealed himself to Samuel. Samuel listened to God and spent time with him as he did. God set him as a mouthpiece to the nation. We read of this down in verse 19. The Lord was with Samuel as he grew up, and he let none of Samuel's words fall to the ground. Verse 20. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba recognized that Samuel was attested as a prophet of the Lord. The Lord continued to appear at Shiloh, and there he revealed himself to Samuel through his word. Samuel's words and influence would go on to reach the entire nation. He learned to know the voice of God and to obey him, regardless of the circumstances. He understood what it was to be still and know his God. You see, in the quietness and the stillness of night, Samuel stopped and heard God speak. And friends, something special happens when we take time to spend with God. As we grow closer to God, we might not notice it, but our words and our life will begin to influence people and places around us instead of us being influenced. The Lord helps us to influence others. All because we stopped. All because we were still before God. All because we took the time to still the constant noise around us. To still our own hearts and to really listen. Friends, so often we want to speak and be heard instead of just being still and listening. But when we're still and listening to God, we give him room to grow us, to change us, to speak to us, to fill us with more of himself so that his life overflows from us and begins to influence those around us. Church, God longs to speak to each and every one of us, to commune with us. It's not always an audible voice, but we find that the Holy Spirit speaks to us through the pages of Scripture, through the counsel of godly friends. And he gives us a witness in our spirits. If God speaks something to you, it will never for one moment contradict what he has written in his word. As much as you can, don't neglect spending time in the word of God. If you don't like reading, get an audio copy. Have it playing while you're driving, going for a walk, maybe even for a run. There's even scripture that's been written into songs, as we had this morning, the Psalms. Soak yourselves in the word of God and do it intentionally. Morning, noon, and evening. Whenever it is that you get the chance, get into this book and allow God to speak his heart to you. In Psalm 119, verse 130, it says, "The unfolding of your words gives light. It gives understanding to the simple." And simple here means someone who is willing to be humble and say, "I don't know, but God knows." God's words brings light to our souls and understanding where we need it. But it requires us to be intentional, to take the time to listen and not just here. You see, revelation is something that comes in the intentional stilling. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. This was the posture of Samuel's heart. God spoke and Samuel came to know and discern the voice of God. Jesus says in the New Testament that his sheep hear his voice and he knows them and they in turn follow him. Can that be said of each one of us, individually and collectively as a church? Do we know Jesus intimately? Do we spend so much time with him that we know his voice instantly and we can recognize it anywhere? He said that he knows us and calls us to follow him. But for one moment, he doesn't force us. In this fast-paced world today, it's easy just to hear and not really listen. Or even to have selective hearing. Can you think of anything that might make listening hard for you? Maybe it's the busyness, the noise, the stress, work, family drama, personal insecurities, anger, temptations. For Eli, he had become comfortable and didn't really want to listen to anything that might challenge him too much or confront his ideals, especially if it cost him too much to give it up. I wonder, can anyone relate to Eli? Eli became a comfortable and complacent hearer. Overcome with fear, someone who did not want to be removed from a life of familiarity. After all, he was receiving good and tasty cuts of meat, and he was being well fed. And he was no longer concerned about the eternal stake of his household. But even though Eli made his choice, Samuel was there. And the Lord was with him and was speaking through him, helping him to be his mouthpiece to his people. Again, here are two men who made two different choices. Both had the same opportunity to listen to God. One just heard, and the other really listened and obeyed. Folks, to listen requires an action. And it's usually an action that we might find uncomfortable to do. To listen requires an act of laying down what we want to do to follow God's will. This even means that we might have to step out of our comfort zones. So this week, as you go about your daily lives, take some time to think about if you are a comfortable hearer or an obedient listener. Remember the parable at the beginning. Which son did the will of the Father? As we listen to the Lord's voice and follow him, as we know, love, and serve him, and allow him to come and have his way in us, his testimony is revealed within us. And he becomes a natural part of our everyday conversation and life. And when this happens, we can faithfully declare God to the generation that's coming after us. Let me close this morning with a few words from a few verses in Psalm 78. It says, beloved ones, listen to this instruction. Open your heart to the revelation of this mystery that I share with you. A parable and a proverb are hidden in what I say. An intriguing riddle from the past. We've heard true stories from our fathers about our rich heritage. We will continue to tell our children and not hide from the rising generation the great marvels of our God. His miracles and power that have brought us all this far. Let me close in prayer. Oh Lord, we thank you this morning that you alone call for each one of us to love and follow you. That you give us a choice, Lord. Help us not to just hear, but to truly be listeners. Help us to use what we've heard today to make us more like you, to stop and listen to your plan and purposes. And that when we hear your voice, we would not be like the son that said yes, but then didn't do it. But more like the son who, although he started off saying no, he was convicted and ended up obeying. Oh Lord, we love you so much and we want to exalt you with all of our lives. And we ask all these things in your holy name. Amen and amen. Thanks, musicians.
I don't know about you, but I'm married to a very godly woman. She's a good listener. If I'm watching the football and I'm going off, she'll say, "Don't say that. Settle down. What are you going on about, you know?" I got a bit excited yesterday when the Broncos are winning. We're going to stand and sing the goodness of God. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing all the goodness of God. Goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I am able. let's always be open to your voice and because you direct us in our life and look for opportunities to serve you. So everyone go into the world and be the best that you can be with God's help and guidance. So send us out in the power of your Spirit, God. Amen. Thank you for this morning. Amen.